This is really a game of distribution. The business is successful because we provide lots and lots of places for customers to go and put cash in and take cash out. And we spent a long time thinking about that distribution. That's something that network operators do very well. Other organizations do, of course. But network operators excel at finding places to sell airtime, which is really electronic value in its own right. And on that curve, you'll see that we actually got the ratio wrong. The customer base was growing so quickly, we couldn't have enough agents in the marketplace. And the customers were getting frustrated because they couldn't find an agent. And when they could find an agent, that agent didn't have enough electronic money float to be able to do a transaction. But we've stabilized out now at a ratio of around 600 customers for one agent. But it took us a long time to get to that point where we realized that, look, this is the optimum density of agents against customers. And this really is a quality issue as well. Those agents have to be trained. You have to spend time with them. You have to be very hard on agents that try and mis-sell these products or take cash off the customer as an extra deal. And Safaricom took about 70 of the first 500 customers off that agent base because they weren't doing the job properly. So focusing on distribution was key, and I think that's something that is a lesson which I think we'll be taking into lots of other mobile commerce services going forward. So just on that point, what do we see happening and what are we doing within Signal Point now when we see lots of schemes like M-Pesa around the world? In fact, you can now buy mobile payment platforms like the one I built in Vodafone from around 40 vendors. If you track what the GSMA, which is the Network Operators Trade Association, does, they say there's over 120 schemes live now around the world that look and feel like M-Pesa. Not all of them have got to the scale we got to in Kenya, but it's happening slowly. It's certainly happening in places like Pakistan, where there's over a million customers now using the Tamir service. It's happening in Bangladesh. It's happening in West Africa and East Africa. There are schemes in Brazil which look very promising. So it's starting to happen. There have been some frustrations that it hasn't happened as quickly, but it's definitely moving in the right direction. Now, what we can see happening is that mobile payments per se will become commoditized. We think every large network operator will offer mobile payments as part of its product set in the next few years. And I think wherever you go, you're going to be able to find a scheme that looks like M-Pesa, especially in emerging markets, and be able to do cash in and cash out. Now, we could debate for a long time the exact timing of that, but what we can see happening, and we know where the money is being spent in the industry, this will come at one point. So the biggest potential barrier in the way is the regulators. Will the regulators let this happen? Will they let the network operators or bank network operator partnerships move forward at scale? But what we think is more interesting and more exciting is, well, once you can move a small amount of money around for a very low cost, that actually opens doors into other product and service ideas and concepts. You know, we've got a business just starting here. This is what Signal Point is up to now. We've got three new ventures. We've got a business just starting here in Mumbai, which is about primary healthcare advice over the phone. And the guys are in the room. My colleagues are in the room with us here today. And I think there's a session tomorrow where that's going to be discussed in more depth, so I won't go into that now. We've got a mobile savings product running in Kenya, which is entirely mobile-based. So we're offering customers to use that M-Pesa transaction engine to build up lump sum savings over time, and we do it entirely through the phone. And of course, this is more complex. The business case is less easy to prove. We've got to convince the regulators that we're protecting those customer funds. But we can see around the world lots and lots of opportunities for some of these more relevant mobile savings products coming through to the, over the next couple of years. And I'd like to just finish with an example of another product which we're working on called Copa Solar, which is in the energy space. Now, I can almost hear your brains going, hang on, mobile and energy, how do these things link up? Well, if you take sub-Saharan Africa, 70% of the population are off the electricity grid, and yet they're on the mobile network. What we've done is take some embedded mobile technology and put it into a solar unit. So we've taken a solar panel, a solar lantern, and we've put some mobile technology into that lantern so it becomes a live device on the mobile network. We can see it, we can see when it's on, we can see when it's off, we can monitor data from it. And we think that's actually an opportunity to start breaking down the barrier of affordability for solar units. And I've got a very short video that I'd like to show you around this product called Copa Solar. So if we could play the second video, please.
You know, the first light here, it goes for Simon Kariuki, and I am an agent of Copper Solar at Ogata Ogai Town in Kenya. For reasons now, it is charging. It's charging. Most of our people cannot afford to pay this light. When you tell them, like, you pay in cash. So, but when you tell them that you can give them in installments and they pay slowly by slowly, to their mind, it comes as if they can afford.
To pay slow, copper solar is good more than to buy cash, because I don't have cash every day. I don't have money every day.
Here, I'm doing my work. My name is Nathan Kimoni Wainaina, and I'm a customer of copper solar. Message saying, my balance is 39.20 of copper solar. When I pay 39.20, the copper solar unlimited will be mine forever.
There's so many people who like it. Even the people from Narok, they ask me. From Narok, some people from other areas, they ask me, how can we get this one?
So to me, when we come up with such a product like this one, and we are selling to them in an installment way, then I think we also teaching them a way of saving, and at the end of the day, achieving. And from there, probably you find, okay, by the way, I saved it for the copper solar. If I can save for something else, then I can still have something else. In about 5 years, I do expect very many homes in our rural areas, and in the areas where the electricity has not reached, to be covered through the copper solar, and to see that something that started as something that they did not think it would need help has come up to be a big help.
No, I could not think I could have been like this. It is like a miracle.
So, there we are. It's a really simple idea. We know people can't afford solar energy. We can embed some technology in that, so they pay per use. Every time they turn that lamp on, we collect a small payment. We can use the M-Pesa transaction engine to do that, but it can work on any mobile payment scheme. And then after 180 uses, that customer suddenly owns that solar lantern. Now, if we'd said, look, that's $50, you've got to find your way to pay $50 to start with, actually, that's pretty difficult to do. You know, it's quite difficult for a consumer on low income to find $50 to purchase that asset. If they go and take a loan out, then they're going to be involved with all the detail of taking out a credit product from a microfinance institute and paying a lot more money. We've simply said, let's use mobile technology smartly. Let's use our distribution. Let's use the fact we can monitor things out there in the network. And let's collect small payments at very low cost. And then suddenly we think we've got quite an exciting business model in there. We think you can take that model into anything electronic out there in the mobile network. So you can, anything that needs turning on or turning off. So water irrigation pumps, sewing machines. You know, you could take that copper solar model and simply embed that technology. And every time you get some usage, then you collect a small payment. So it's quite an exciting space. I think this, what we're going to see over the next few years, are more models like this come to the fore, where suddenly, if you can move small amounts of money around, you could build up relationships with customers who have a mobile phone in their hand and potentially another asset. You can start to generate data around that relationship and find ways which deliver something to the consumer at a fair price and become commercially sustainable as well going forward. So I think I'll leave it at that point and just open the floor to any questions around M-Pesa or all things mobile. Stunned silence.
Yes, there is.
What are the challenges in having the question adopted in other countries also?
Yeah, okay, that's a very good question. And 4 years ago, we launched in Kenya. It's got a lot of media. So the question, in case everybody didn't hear it, what are the challenges in getting M-Pesa running in other markets? So we've been 4 years since launch. It started getting some media attention probably about a year after launch, and it got very big very quickly. And we've seen a whole raft of other mobile payment schemes start, but they haven't grown as quickly. And there are lots of reasons why, but I can name a few. I already referred to one, and that's the proposition itself. people have tried to take it too far too quickly and have gone for a mobile banking proposition. That's quite difficult. Perhaps the biggest one is the regulators. You know, what's happened in Kenya was the regulators said, look, we don't really understand what that is. We can see that you're not investing customers' funds when they make an M-Pesa transaction and that all you're providing is a payment service. And therefore, we're going to let you operate. Now, not all regulators, central banks around the world, have allowed the entry of non-banks into that space. So here in India, the RBI in 2008 issued some guidelines which said, look, the only people who can provide electronic money out there in the marketplace are the banks. And yes, we understand the network operators have certain aspects which they can bring to the table, distribution, the fact you've got a device and you're moving data around, but that product must be offered by a bank. And they're starting to relax a little bit, and over the last year or so, we've seen the RBI here start to allow a few variations of models take place. But actually, if the regulators decide only banks can play, then suddenly it's quite a difficult step for a bank to move down into that type of customer group, because these are typically unbanked customers or underbanked. They typically don't have a credit history. This payment service isn't something that banks do particularly well. I mean, there are other organizations that do. And if we were to look at these 120 schemes, which we now know are running around the world, about half of them are now run by network operators, but the other half are actually combinations of mobile operators working with banks or even third parties. So third parties are coming into the market and saying, look, we're a payment service provider. Let us do a payments, basic payment service, and then we'll work in partnership with banks to offer savings and credit and network operators to let the transactions flow properly. But it's not happened quickly. Everyone got a bit frustrated about, well, why aren't we seeing more M-Pesas like we've seen in Kenya? Why aren't we seeing that in other places? You know, it's actually quite a difficult thing to get right. We were fortunate in Kenya. We had a very committed CEO. He put very good people on the project, and we were able to focus on driving it forwards. And you know, there's another problem. Network operators are still growing very quickly and are growing their core, but all they do is sell phones and voice, and that's all they need to do. And when you talk to them about mobile financial services, actually it's complex and it's difficult to understand. There's a lot more risks associated with it. And so you've also got that element. Network operators aren't really hungry enough yet to sort of drive very hard at that space, because they're still putting up network and acquiring customers at an astonishing rate in many emerging markets.
Yeah. Thank you.
Cost per transaction in Kenya, the lowest cost transaction is around 30 Kenyan shillings, which somebody might know a US cent translation is probably about 15 or 16 US cents, I'm guessing, 15 or 16 for an account to an account transfer.
Just last question, please.
Building up on the question about connecting with if telecoms are allowed to do this and banks are allowed to do this.
Yeah.
In Kenya, I'm not sure how correct I am, but there was a partnership with Equity. How did that work?
Yeah, so about a year ago, Equity Bank, which is the largest bank in Kenya, partnered with Safaricom and launched a product called M-Kesho, which is use your M-Pesa account to pay into a savings account. And I think they initially got some very good uptake, and I think they've got about several hundred thousand customers now using that. Now, whether or not that's actually a standard savings account with a bank is a product which is particularly relevant to the 14.5 million M-Pesa users, I'm not sure. I think we'll see some of that customer base use it, but actually it's just a standard savings account, and what you're able to get from it is 3 or 4% interest per year. But if you live on low income, your cash flow is very, very volatile. What's more relevant to you is liquidity, and not gaining 2 or 3% for long.